means to be a patriot. You know, that's our mascot. And here at the high school, we preach patriot pride. Okay? Patriot pride is something I think every single day we should be preaching and practicing. What does that look like? That's dedication. That's commitment. That's hard work. It's loyalty. It's not a matter how many games we win. It's not a matter of what we personally have done. It's a matter of what we've done as a school. Okay? And I thought today would be a good opportunity to have a speaker come in and kind of talk to you exactly about what this means to our school and what it means to be a patriot. I'm extremely proud of every one of you in this school. You should be of yourself, and that's the reason we're having this assembly, is to show you that and have somebody demonstrate it to you, the real meaning of what it means to be a patriot. Okay? So if you just sit tight, I'm going to go get him real quick. All right?
It's Donald Trump. Donald Trump is coming down.
Hunter Ross.
Okay, so you all know Staff Sergeant Russ, right? He's our National Guard recruiter. He does a lot for our school. And obviously, he is a very decorated man. There is a piece of apparel here that is very respected in our country. But I'd like to tell you, there's more to this than that. Next one, come out. This is not an actual assembly on leadership because we exemplify that perfect. This is much more important than that, okay? This assembly today has absolutely nothing to do with patriot pride. It has to do everything with what it means to be a real-life patriot, okay? Our guest of honor, if you see our shirts here, our guest of honor are the McNeil family. Our shirts you see on the front have HT, and on the back, it has Mr. Dan McNeil's name. Okay, for those of you that do not know, Mr. McNeil is deployed overseas in the Middle East someplace, protecting our rights and our freedoms that make us the greatest country in the world. And this is a family, and they're our family. So will you please come out here, Mrs. McNeil, and your family, will you please go sit right over there. Sacrifice for not only their family, but for all of us in America. have been planning this for about a month. We got the shirts printed up, and trying to play hide and go seek with Miss McNeil has been an interesting battle. Okay? We do have some presentations here for you. We do have some speakers. But I think most importantly, I think the McNeil family gets to see how many people support you and your husband. So, with that being said, we are going to start this presentation off. We have a little Patriot Pride slideshow that we are going to show all of you. So please just sit back and enjoy.
Thank you.
his name's on the back of our shirts, and he's the reason we are celebrating this great moment today. Okay? The next thing we're going to have here is Mr. Caleb McNeil. This would be Mrs. McNeil's oldest boy. He is going to come up here and give you a little speech, a little presentation for all of you.
Surprise. I'm not dad, but I'm your favorite son, so I hope that's a close second. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Caleb McNeil. I'm the son of Dan and Sarah, and the brother of Carson and Colin Cambry. I'm a pretty familiar face around here, but I graduated in 2016. I went to Tulane here till I was in ninth grade. Then I went to Redfield and graduated from Redfield in 2016. I spent my first year, during the summer I worked and waited around until my training dates came in September 2016. I left for JBSA, WAC in San Antonio, and I spent 2 months there doing my Air Force basic training. I was assigned to the Flight 739, 323rd Training Squadron, 737 Training Group of the Air Combat Training Command, or Air Educational Training Command, sorry. I took my military physical, my MEPS, back in December 2015, and then enlisted that same day, so I've been in for almost 2 years now, coming out of the end of the year, I'll be in for 2 years, but, so I graduated Air Force Basic Military Training on November 4th, spent another week, and then I left for Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri, in 14th of November. There, I started my classes to become the 30931 emergency manager for the South Dakota Air National Guard. I got back the end of March and worked the whole summer, and now I'm back at school waiting for my turn to go. So I'm gonna throw a real quick plug in there. For those, you know, some of you seniors, juniors, thinking about doing the military, do it right away because you're going to go into college. Totem's a pretty good cash, so definitely throw that plug in there. I'm living like a king compared to everybody else in college, so that kind of gives an idea. But so, as you already know, like Mr. Nelson said, it is day of the deployed. We're here to celebrate our dad's deployment. Yes, I said celebrate because this is something that less than 1% of the population is called to do. Less than 1% is given is called by the President and the Secretary of Defense to go over and, you know, keep our nation safe. The amount of trust put in their hands is incredible. So we are celebrating today. This is not a sad day by any means. So, my dad, Senior Master Sergeant Daniel McNeil, is overseas right now. This is our third deployment, so I don't know. For me, it's a little bit easier, but as time goes, I mean, you start getting used to those things, and especially when you get practice under your belt, these things become easier. But it's a unique challenge. We're not an active duty family. We're a guard family, but nonetheless, me leave for training, drill duty, temporary duty. I mean, it's not much. We're only asked to give a weekend every month and a couple weeks out of the year. I mean, like I said, it's not much. If you've been in long enough, it's like you're not even gone. It's just, you know, part of the job. But they add up, and these things happen to land on, you know, like a sporting event, a Christmas, you know, during Christmas, birthday party, something like that, and that makes it hard. A family gathering or something simple like a duck hunt, you know, that's one, two, I mean, duck hunts, family gatherings, whatever, all those things add up, and it starts to wear on you a little bit. You don't know it, but it does. I mean, it's not a big deal right away, but because, I mean, these things become like clockwork after you've been in. I mean, our dad's been in for 25, 26 years, so it's nothing new to us, and it's, I mean, it's become part of our routine. You begin to plan around those things, and as they come, they can't be avoided, so you just take it and you move on. But sometimes, you know, you can go down there and you can spend time with your loved one. I know we've done that many times. And that gives us the opportunity to spend time with other families as well. And those are the people that you stick with when you go through something like this. This is our family during peacetime. So that call comes for them to leave. It comes almost in a year in advance. And every time I think I speak for my family when I say this, it comes as a shock at first. The last time our dad left for our overseas deployment was, I was in fifth grade, I remember that. But it's been a while ago, but it still comes as a shock. But all you can do is shake it off and keep going on about your daily life, trying to make the best out of those days before he leaves. You can't forget that, and you can't shake it off. It just it always reminds. It's always in the back of your head. You're always reminded of it. So the days tick by. That stress grows with every passing second. There's a lot that needs to be done. There's a lot to be prepared and get prepared for when they leave. You know, they have to prepare to deploy. They have all their responsibilities at home, as well as those responsibilities that they're in their military career as well. So it's hard to know what that stress feels like without experiencing it. But it is a high level of stress, and you know your family is stressing as well. We have to get ready to, you know, take care of the house, pay the bills, make sure the family's fed, and just that simple stress of them not being there is enough. Sometimes it, you know, puts you on your knees. You almost want to tap out, but you can't. All those days leading up, you know, as it gets closer and closer, the time doesn't feel enough, and it almost gets to the point where you know, you feel like those days are wasted, and you just want them to leave already so you can just get it started and you know, get this done with. We felt that every deployment, I think we just want them to get out of here and, you know, go get it done and come back. But those days drag, and you can't speed it up and you can't speed it down no matter how hard you try. comes right back. You don't feel like you're prepared enough. You don't, and you can't, you know, pick up the phone and call, hey, what should I do about this? You simply just have to find a way to, like, take care of business on your own. You can't call. He's getting ready to leave, and you don't want to put that stress on them. So you have to figure things out on your own. And just that thought by itself puts enough stress on you. It's inevitable that they're going to leave. And when they go, you know, like I said, that preparation, you know, seemed like you might have been preparing every day, all day, from the time that you know that they're going to leave to the time that they leave. You know, you could have been preparing all day, every single day, you know, making plans, making checklists of what to do around the house, you know, leaving directions. It all doesn't seem enough. And you're stuck with that stress. They can't take care of it. So now that they've left, we're about 3 months in, and it seems like every day is, you know, seems fast, but at the same time there's those days that they drag on. There's certain challenges they have to overcome every day. Flat tire that Dad usually changes, we have to change ourselves now. When me and Carson and Colin get ready to go on a weekend of hunting, we can't, we don't have the time to go out and look for ducks because Dad always did that. He always did all the calling to the landowners to get us a spot. You know, we have to figure that out. strong, where our fire too hot, and not even the hand of God himself can break that hot. So, I'm done now. I apologize that I'm not Morgan Freeman or Dr. Phil by any means, but I appreciate you all for doing this for us. Not out.
back for the community and give back for the country. Military is only one way to do that. What I chose, what my oldest boy chose, but it's not the only way. To give back to your community, to give back to your country. I hope that you'll think about that, and just how important that is.
Seen a grown man will cry. Gonna have another one here in a little bit. It's gonna hit home. It's about the senior leader, and I'm having a hard time up here. Just I'm looking at the family. I've been there just myself. But it's about the senior leader who is halfway through his third deployment, and I know he said it in the video, when you're halfway through, I just started to get complacent. So whoever had this whole idea with the family, this is going to help him, to bring him home and help you to get through the next little stretch. The midpoint, halftime, this is huge. No matter what branch of the military, you have the Air Force, Air National Guard, you have Army National Guard, you have the Army, Navy, Marines, probably more veterans in here who have served. Just in front of the deal, it says U.S. And we can just always say, United we stand. So thank you for wearing the boots. Now that we're probably about ready to hang up, right? Right? No. We'll put him on the spot. But he said it's a 1% on that joining the military service. It's a volunteer force. South Dakota, Midwest, with a mentality that the military has. Just for the Midwest with soldiers, it is literally second to none. The work ethic that is instilled in the schools, the communities, the farms, that work ethic carries into the military, and that 114th fighter wing, if you don't know, is highly decorated. It's one good unit to be in. And if you want a good unit to recruit, you can talk to him. It's a heck of a unit. When that video played, that song on there, I believe, is by Dusty Evans. When I deployed the first time, I had bought a guitar, and that was the first song I learned. So I would talk about getting emotional. Had me in for a loop on this one. Crap. Ain't gonna do that again. No. But no. But just for the family, huge thanks. The parents, the wife, mom, huge thanks. If you want to stand up, I just gotta give you a hug.
You know, I think we got to give some thank yous for this to happen. You know, we first got to thank the McNeil family for allowing us to have this celebration, and thank Mr. McNeil for everything he does for our country, not just for our community, not for our school, not for his family, but for our country. I think we got to thank Mrs. Miller, Mr. Clark, all the staff here that was willing to put forth some generosity and some flexibility to make this happen. So as a thank you to your family, we do understand what you're going through, and it's tough to be a mom. I had to be a mom for a couple days. I would never want that job ever. We want to give you some things to personally thank you for everything, and hopefully it helps make this 50% that's left a little bit easier for you and your kids. So our staff has put some things together for your family, and we would like to present those things to you now. So the first one up here is Caleb and Bailey, and they are going to present you with something.
As you said, I'm Caleb Warner, this is Bailey Hander, and to show our appreciation to Dan and his family on behalf of the student body and FCCLA and FFA, we are presenting you with these pizzas. So thank you guys.
Just prior to this happening, and we were talking about the last minute things, and I said, is there anybody in the bathroom? And he said, Tristan's in the bathroom. And I said, okay. So I started talking a little louder, and the door opens up, and we were talking about it. I turned around, here she was, right there, come right in. So this has been a plan that's been, it's been difficult. There's a lot of people that put this together, but on behalf of the high school staff, we got you a little pampered gift basket here. She's got her fuzzy blanket and her yarn and some of her smelly stuff that she has in her room. And there's also a pedicure deal where you and Cambry can go and get your nails done, I guess. And, so, and for you boys, you got these Reese's Pieces. All the staff has those, but anybody who is interested, I will send it to the elementary as well, and you can send them home. You're not obligated to buy those, but we are going to sell them, and all the money that we do raise for them will go to the McNeils so they can maybe plan a trip to a motel some weekend or whatever. High school kids, junior high kids, it's just a lot easier for you to just come up and say, hey, I would like a shirt. I will still make some forms up if your parents want to buy them. That's fine. Elementary, I'll do the same. I'll send a home to, I'll send a flyer to all the teachers, and they can do that as well. And so we'll open that up, and then all the money we raise will go to you guys. Thank you very much.
Yeah, fall out.